First, I just want to say thanks for having me here. It's always great to talk, to come here and talk before the great audiences that we get here at B&H. I always find it a privilege to talk about photography, talk about something that I love, that I'm passionate about, because I can't really ask for much more than that. So it's always wonderful, and it's always great to share and kind of find a common sort of perspective on something that we all do. So I always come at speaking and presenting and teaching like something that we're all going to benefit from, because I think that creates a sense of community, connection, what have you. So that always is exciting for me. Composition is probably my favorite part of photography. There's nothing more that I enjoy than bringing the camera to my eye when I'm out in the field somewhere and exploring this whole new world inside this canvas that a camera makes. And the best part about it is that we get to share that with others. We get to share what we create, what we see, how we put everything together within this particular rectangle or this particular frame. We get to share that with others. And it's equally challenging, frustrating, and ripe with lots of failure all the time. And I think that's probably a part of what attracts me to it so much. It's that because it's a constant challenge, and being the kind of person that I am, I just find that the more the challenge there is, the harder it is, the more I want to do it. Why? Because I think that the more difficult something is, the more worthwhile it makes it, the more meaningful it makes it. And anything that's easy, it just, in my experience anyway, hasn't been that meaningful, hasn't lasted that long. It's the things that really are hard that really become worthwhile. Composition is one of those things that's easy to talk about, but difficult to explain. Anyone can talk about composition in sort of broad terms and talk about rules and that kind of thing, but explaining composition, explaining what it actually is, how to do it effectively, is a lot more difficult. At least it is for me when I've tried to explain it, because I realized, oh, it isn't quite as easy to put into words. So as I prepared for this talk and talking about composition on the workshops I teach, I thought about all the different approaches to composition. Not everyone, but there are many different kinds of schools of thought and different approaches depending on photographers. And if you think about composition outside of photography, which I am going to talk about, not only in the visual arts, but even in music, there are many different ways to think about it. I realized that there's no way I could even begin to teach them all, never mind understand them myself. So this talk is really my summary, my notes and thoughts about composition, if you will, that I've explored in my own photography. So I'm not saying it's the right way. I'm not saying it's the only way. It's the only way that I know best. And because I know it best, because it's what I've tried to do myself, then that's, I think, what I feel most comfortable sharing with you. And I hope that it inspires you to approach composition with a little more confidence and look for your own insights, because ultimately composition is going to be a subjective thing, a personal thing. It should be, because it's how you see the world. So let's start with a basic composition of basic definition of composition, right? If you look in the dictionary, at least the dictionary that I have on my computer, composition, at least visual composition, is defined as the artistic arrangement of the parts of a picture. And that's pretty broad and basic, and again, sounds more like talking about composition than actually explaining it. My favorite definition of composition is Edward Weston's definition, which is: to compose a subject well means no more than to see and present it in the strongest manner possible. And I love that definition of composition, because it is at the same time specific and broad. It is both tells you what it is and also leaves room for creative interpretation. And all art really is about that. It's about being specific and being limiting in what you do, but at the same time finding creativity within that. So composition for me is probably the essence of any visual artwork. It establishes the relationships between the objects in the frame, and the relationships. Relationships are really everything in composition. It's how one thing relates to another that makes a composition work. You just can't isolate one thing, whether a rock or a tree, water, etc. It's how those things relate to each other that really determine whether we're seeing something as strongly as possible, as Edward Weston said. How to see something as strongly as possible. Obviously, we use things like lines, shapes, forms, light, which I'm going to talk about each of those in depth, to compose, right? To put something together. and how these elements relate to one another, again, back to relationships, that is really going to define the context by which the viewer, the person looking at your pictures, is going to interpret the image. And more than that, how they're going to give it any kind of meaning, the way you've put these elements together. Meaning is what gives life to an image. Without meaning, your image really doesn't have much life, at least any extended life, beyond the first viewing. And it's what connects the photographer, what connects you guys as photographers to the people who are looking at your pictures. It's what makes doing something creative, which is what photography is or should be, it's what makes it worthwhile. Composition is also near and dear to my heart because it is a bridge that I've used to get from my previous so-called art form that I practice, which is music, and I did for a career for about 12 to 15 years. It kind of bridged music to photography because I found composition to be the really strong unifying thing between both music and photography. The one thing that I think that I learned from music as I started to learn how to become a photographer is that music isn't static. Music has a flow to it. Music breathes. You just don't listen to a piece of music for 1 second. You listen to it over time, or you go on a journey with a piece of music, or music takes you from one emotional state to another. And I think any good composition does the same thing or tries to do the same thing. What interests me the most in the comparison of music and photography is creating a sense of movement similar to, like I said, the way music moves you from one point to another. And that point might be a long time, a place, emotion, tension, but it's never static. At least music isn't. And I think the strongest compositions do the same. They have a sense of movement or of energy. And that energy, I'm not talking about psychic energy, I'm talking about the energy that you feel when you look at a picture, the way it moves it from one place in the picture to another, the kind of feeling that you get from the picture. That's what I try as much as possible to capture in the work that I do, regardless of how often I fail, which seems to be the majority of the time. But as I said, that's what makes it more meaningful, and that's what I try to impart to students. So as a musician, as an arranger, as a photographer, I've recognized some certain similarities that have shaped my approach to composition in general. Now, consider some of these similarities. There's composition and arrangement in both music and photography. So the way we put things together, whether it's musical notes or musical instruments, or the way you arrange music, the way you arrange the elements in your frame, that's a part of composition. Music and both photography both have a rhythmic component to them. So there's a certain visual rhythm that every visual artwork has, how quickly or slowly you move through an image, when your eye rests, when your eye moves, how you sort of move around through an image is very similar to, again, the rhythm that we can find in music. High frequencies and low frequencies, the things that you play around with in your car radio to make your music sound as good as possible, right? Or in your stereo system or in your iPod, iPad, whatever, are similar to highs and lows, highlights and shadows in music, and just similar to how low frequencies in music have a certain stabilizing sense to them, how they make us feel a certain way. Some low frequencies you can't even hear, you more feel them than hear them. You can see that with the way elephants communicate with one another, the frequencies are so low that you can't hear them, but they certainly feel them. Well, deep black shadows in pictures have a way of also communicating that same sense of feeling, and it isn't so much black or deep shadows that communicate that, it's how you compose them or arrange them with another part of the image. Remember, anything that's dark is going to emphasize anything that's light around it. And that's a very powerful thing that you can use in composition. Tonality and color or warmth. There's certainly a lot of warmth in music, and there's certainly a lot of warmth in photography, depending on how warm or cool you make an image based on color, based on feel. All those things elicit certain emotions. Another thing that I like to think about in my images, and you can too, is volume, or how loud a picture is, or how quiet a picture is, how calming a picture is, how serene a picture is. You can make a picture very loud and sort of very in your face, so to speak, or you can make an image that is very soothing and quiet, or again, a lot of those words that you hear people talk about. So I'm not the least bit suggesting that you need to become a musician or go off and study music, although that can't hurt, obviously. But you don't need to do that. You just need to appreciate and understand how important image design is, designing your image compositionally. It doesn't mean that you become a slave to design principles. It means that you understand how these things work as tools so that you can get your story across. They're worth studying, and it can probably improve your photography more than any other single thing, which is why we constantly, even though it's cliche, but it's true, we constantly find these examples of amazing images that are made with, let's call them subpar cameras. I'm not going to mention any brand names or any models, but you see great images made on any camera because the composition is what grabs you, whereas vice versa, we see that all the time with my own work. I got great cameras and I still struggle to make a good composition, but that's what I want to get at. That's what I focus on the most. So in a lot of ways, when we're talking about composition, you know, the camera and whatnot really isn't all that important. It's what you see that matters. So the challenge is, how do we use composition to get closer to our inner emotions, to express what we think and feel? How can we use composition to do that? You can't really use anything else. You can't really use the technology or the camera. So you have to use your sense of the way you see things. And the key to understanding that, I think, is that there is a language, a visual language, that can be utilized and is involved in all visual artwork. And the more you understand about that visual language, then again, the more you can use it effectively. So I like to use an analogy of actual language, like, you know, English, Spanish, what have you, to compare to photography, because that's something that we all understand and we use intuitively. And just how you can combine letters into words and words into sentences, and then sentences into poetry, for example. So we went from grammar, rules, to poetry, which is something totally different. We can do the same thing with the basic building blocks of composition to convey ideas, emotion, or to tell a story. Just like you don't think about grammar when you speak, I'm not thinking about grammar now. I'm not thinking about nouns and pronouns and adjectives and all those kinds of things. It's because it's second nature. I do it and I practice it so much, and I've learned how to do it right and wrong, that I can just focus now on being as clear as possible. The same thing happens with photography when you internalize compositional principles, so that you don't walk around thinking about the grammar of photography. You do it first, you do for a long time, but after a while it becomes second nature, and then you can sort of use it without thinking about it, but you have to learn it first. And there are a lot of basic principles. So what are the challenges? Managing complexity, right? How do you manage the complexity of a scene, especially a landscape scene, not letting your images become too busy, not having too many competing elements? Another way is understanding how we see and react to a scene versus how a camera sees. All right, that's more of a technical issue, but just understanding that a camera sees things differently than the way we see them, to use kind of a human term there. We see things one way, a camera sees them another. We have a very psychological way of walking into a landscape and narrowing down our field of vision to the things that interest us. When you use a camera has no way of discerning what's interesting from what's not. Only you can do that through composition. Camera just takes it all in equally. So you can improve that intuition by learning the basics of visual design, expanding your visual literacy. Just like a writer tries to read as much as possible so that he understands how language is used by, let's say, the masters of literature, we can do the same thing with composition and photography. We can learn from looking at others. And one of the things that I've learned a lot from in terms of a compositional foundation is not only the greats of photography, which we all know, but going back before that and looking at painting and landscape painting, which has stood even a longer test of time. And they are using the same visual language because it's the same art form. It might be created in a different manner, might be a different medium, but it's the same art form. So paintings like this, which though they're paintings, we've all come across scenes like this that look very similar, are ways in which we can learn about composition. This is a painting by Albert Bierstadt, who's one of the great Hudson River School painters. And it's a great way to improve your visual sense, your intuition about what works. And if you look at a painting like this and you know basic ideas of photography, side light, backlight, highlights and shadows, lines, shapes, diagonals, all those things are included in this picture or in this painting. This is Tequendama Falls in New Granada. This is Frederick Church, another great landscape painter of the Hudson River School. Again, you can see all the elements there that we find when we study composition and photography. They're all there. And I like to study these paintings because, again, they're made by paintings that have stood the test of time and are in some of the world's greatest museums. This is Jamaica Bay by Frederick Church. Right? Very abstract, very sublime, very the color, a lot of great use of color, great use of diagonals. Everything is there. And I just like the way they sort of use, not the technology, but the way they felt about the landscape to paint these scenes. They weren't distracted so much by the technology. They had technology. They had the technology of paints and brushes and canvas, but it wasn't a technology based on how you can use these tools more than what they could feel. They wanted to feel it first. A lot of these paintings are just going out into the field, making little drawings, little ideas, little sketches, and then going back into the studio and try to recreate what they felt when they were there. And that's really what we should be trying to do as well. One last one. This is Looking Down Yosemite Valley by another Albert Bierstadt painting. Again, you can see how they look so photorealistic because they're looking at nature and taking the elements that we see in nature, like light and shadow, backlighting, etc., color. So again, I urge you to sort of don't underestimate the power of studying painting in terms of learning learning composition for photography. So let's start with some basic principles, because the basic principles, the simplicity of anything is always the thing that's going to carry you through the end, because it's usually the simplest things that make the biggest impact. These might seem sort of common sense, and they might seem to be something that doesn't have to be repeated. Include only the essentials, less is more. But I can tell you, as a workshop leader for the last 6 years, it is the single most challenging thing that all my students have, which is how to make an image that's simple. I've never, almost never, and I only say that because I am not going to guarantee that my memory is 100%, but I almost never had a student show me a picture that was too simple. It's almost always too complex or too complicated or too cluttered or not simple enough. All right, so you can almost never go too simple. If you do, well, you'll find something even more to explore in the picture now if you've gone too simple. But too complex, absolutely. And keep in mind that complex doesn't mean, or simple doesn't mean, going from a landscape to a leaf on a tree. That's not what I mean. Although that could be a way to get more simple. But by simple, I mean how simple the statement is, how simple the story is. As I've said many times before, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony is a lot more complicated than Mary Had a Little Lamb, but the impact and the message of Beethoven is clear. It's you can understand it within the first couple of notes. And that's because he's mastered the tools to make a very clear statement. One of my favorite quotes on simplicity by John Maeda is, simplicity is about subtracting the obvious and adding the meaningful. And I think about that all the time, and I try to instill that in my own work and in students all the time. Subtract the obvious, because it's obvious, and add what's meaningful, okay? Sometimes composition is about isolating a subject from the real world, or capturing a specific moment or in time and space. That's a way of simplifying. All right, here's a picture where I started off with a color image that probably had a lot more elements in the foreground, and I simplified it until I got to what I thought was the basic essence. Could I have simplified it more? Possibly, but this is what I made at the time 6 years ago, and so I move forward from there. One thing about simplifying images, and I mean specifically simplifying images when you go, let's say, from a wide-angle lens to a narrower focal length, is that only you know what you're excluding. The viewer doesn't. So the viewer assumes that what you've included is what's the most are the most important parts of the picture. They don't know what you've left out, and it's irrelevant at that point once you show them the picture. Okay, so don't feel like, oh, but look at what I'm leaving out. Only you know what you're leaving out. Can you make what you're including even that much more powerful? In order to do that, it means that you have to concentrate as much as possible on what's essential in the picture and leaving out what isn't. What is essential? This is another picture where I started out probably with 7 or 8 or 9 or 10 shapes like this along the top of a canyon wall, and I simplified them till I got to the bare essence of what it is that I wanted to capture. Maybe that makes it a little bit more abstract, maybe that makes it a little bit more harder or mysterious to really identify what it is, so be it. Maybe that makes the picture better because it invites more exploration upon repeated viewing. But eliminate things that aren't necessary. Here's another example of, again, simplifying a picture to just bare shapes, bare essentials, right? There's just three elements to this picture. It's the rock, then the trees, and then the background to the trees. And I probably started out, when I mean started out is when I first brought the camera to my eye, I probably started out with including a little bit more. Although, as I said before, as you become a little bit better at finding the things that are most important, you get a little faster at simplifying your pictures. Now, I've shown a couple of pictures that have been horizontal, vertical, perhaps panoramic. If not, there'll be some more later on. So I want to talk a little bit about formats and borders and bring up another key issue, which is cropping, right? So, of course, with composition is going to be defined by the shape of your camera or the shape within that you're putting your picture inside of. And that there are different formats out there, 3:2, which is a standard DSLR format, 4:3, which is Micro Four Thirds, there's panorama, there's horizontal, there's vertical. And I try to explore each of these as equally as I possibly can. Obviously, if you don't have a Micro Four Thirds camera, it's harder to do that, not that you couldn't crop it to that. But I always try to experiment as much as possible with vertical and horizontal pictures. And that's another thing that I see a lot with students is that they tend to sort of default to horizontal format and they rarely go to vertical, maybe because they're not thinking about it, maybe because they feel that it won't be as effective or it just doesn't cross their mind. And when you switch to a vertical format, you change your orientation, you change the way you see the picture, and that can change the way you compose it as well. Sometimes for the better, sometimes not. But it's all there to explore. So here's just a quick comparison of the different formats in both vertical and horizontal. One of the reasons why I like to use a Micro Four Thirds camera is because I like shooting vertically myself, and I always found that in my 35mm DSLR, in a vertical format, it felt a little sort of constrained to me in terms of the left and right space. Whenever I went to vertical, it felt really stretched to me. And because I like vertical, I wanted to have a little bit more of a squarer format. So that's one of the things that I like about shooting with a camera like that is that I have a little bit more of a square format versus a DSLR, 35mm, which tends to be, it works great for horizontal pictures because you get that very nice wide sweeping look compared to a Micro Four Thirds. Taking it a step further though, you can also go panorama. And I wrote 3:1 there, meaning that's the ratio that I tried to stick to, which is 1/3 the height to the width. Now, on a panoramic format like that, I'm probably cropping in camera because I don't have a panoramic camera. I'm probably cropping to that format, but even when I'm taking the picture in the field, if I feel that the strength of the composition is based along a panoramic format, then I will be thinking like that. At least I'm trying in my mind and in my eye, I'm trying to look through the viewfinder so that I'm imagining it as a panorama. So I'm really not paying attention much to the bottom quarter and the top quarter either of the picture. I'm thinking about what's going to be in the center and that the fact that I'm going to crop it afterwards. Part of the reason why I do that in camera, and I mean in my imagination, is because I'm a strong believer. I could use that word, although by belief I mean that this is something that I've experimented with in trying to capture your compositions in the camera before you actually go back and crop. For all of the reasons that I've been talking about here, it has nothing whatsoever to do with the word cheating. It has everything to do with the word seeing compositions in the field as strongly as possible before you bring the camera to your eye. Why? Because if I can see things easier in the field, it means I have a chance to make more images in the field that are stronger, and it means that I am discovering something that attracts my attention, something that I'm resonating with, and I can follow that creative path. If you are trying to do something creative, you know that the longer you can stay in a sort of creative mindset, the better chance you'll have of finding something, of discovering something that works for you, whether you're writing a book or an essay or making a piece of music. The longer you can stay engaged with the creative act, the better you all, better off you'll be. And if you're taking a picture and, let's say, framing it so that you're including a whole lot more than what you need, and then you basically turn off and you go home, and now you're on your computer looking for images within the image, and I've heard people use that phrase, and if that works for them, great. But if you're looking for images within the image, guess what? You can't go back and actually explore any of those ideas because it's too late. You're back home in front of your computer searching for an image using the cropping tool instead of searching for it in a three-dimensional world, which is what landscape photography is. And you know, all of you know, that if you stand here and you move over here, everything changes in a picture. The light, the angles, the subjects, the way things line up in the distance. Okay? When you make that little change, at least in my mind and in the mind of all the students that I've worked with, something clicks. It may click. And all of a sudden now, instead of you standing here, you're 3 feet away finding a much better picture that you never saw because you were stuck in one place, or even worse, because you're back home on your computer and you're looking at the picture that cannot be changed in terms of the angle or perspective or focal length or the direction of light. All you can do is change the cropping. All right, so again, I'm not suggesting that cropping is bad in any way. I'm talking about how we become better at composing images in the field. That's what I'm talking about. So here's some more sort of common sense suggestions, but again, even though it's common sense, I find that it's rarely ever really used or taken to heart because, again, we, for some reason, we just want to go to the more complicated things instead of sticking with the simple things. Every part of an image is important. There isn't any part of an image that is not important. And some of us think that if one part of an image is really strong, and it might in fact be very strong, that somehow the other parts won't be as distracting. I love that word. I get that, asked that question all the time. Well, look at this part of the picture. It's not as distracting now. There's no such thing. Either it is or it isn't distracting. It either belongs or it doesn't belong. You cannot minimize a distraction of something by making something else stronger, because if it's minimally distracting, it's still distracting. And again, we're talking about making the strongest possible images. Control your edges, and that's another thing with the distraction. The frame, the edges of your frame are just as important as the center or the focal point or the thirds, whatever you want to call it, the edges are important. And when you cut things off, talking again specifically now about how I actually compose an image, make sure that you're cutting things off deliberately, or you're aware of the things that you cut off, because when you cut something off, you also create a shape out of that thing that you've cut off, the part that stays in the picture. And that shape can have implications because, as I mentioned before, everything in a composition is about how one thing relates to another, about relationships. So here are some examples of cutting things off deliberately, right? Where I thought about removing and including things in the picture and how cutting things off would affect those things. So for example, you look at the bottom right of the picture, I'm cutting off the little bottom piece of that fern there, but the reason why I'm doing that is so that everything else in the picture lines up, so that I get sort of the diagonal that I want from the bottom right of the tree. The bottom left, I wanted a little bit of space around the tree on the left. And I also didn't want to show the top of the tree on the right. I wanted to keep the tree completely on the right-hand side of the picture. Why? Because that texture and detail is part of a color that I'm trying to use on the right-hand side to then drive the eye into the back of the picture. So again, it's the way that the edges are cut that's, to me, even more important than actually the subject matter within. And of course, the picture really is about light, but just to, again, illustrate how important corners are. Here's another good example of cutting things off, and this is a problem that we all face. I face myself. How do you decide which trees to include and which trees to cut off? How do you decide that which trees on the top you want to leave and which? Well, again, it all depends on relationships. If you've established a pattern, like I think I have here, with all of the trees in the image, I've established a pattern. You see most of the tops of the trees. Cutting off the ones on the very top on the right sort of implies that there are more outside of the field of view. And that's what I want. I want to kind of show you a kind of a, a small little window of this entire landscape. Okay. Also, the trees don't play a center role in the picture. They are really the foreground part of the picture that I want the eye to lead back into the middle in the background, which is where the color is. So again, be very careful about your corners. Here's another example of being very deliberate about the corners, right? You notice that all four corners have diagonals. There are elements in each corner that establish the four diagonals, and what? They just don't establish the diagonals. I hope that they serve to lead the eye in into the picture. And you're gonna hear me mention this idea of leading the viewer through the picture, because that's the same idea of the way music leads the listener through a piece, okay? If in your mind's eye, or actually I could do it right up here, if you eliminate this rock here, okay, you can see, backside, well, you can see how now the bottom left of the picture becomes almost ambiguous. And now it doesn't quite have the same strength that it had with the rock there. When I take this out, now it feels like this bottom end of the picture kind of is loosely laid in place because I didn't notice that it just wasn't doing anything for the picture. All right, so that's what I mean about how you can anchor your images and being very careful about your corners. The vertical format, okay, I like images vertically, like the last one and this one, because they create, I find that they have a very dynamic and energetic feel to them, especially when you use elements in the picture that imply energy already, like vertical trees. And I'm gonna talk about lines soon, vertical and horizontal lines. But they have a sense of moving the eye up and down and creating a lot, again, of that that dynamic that I think is similar to, let's say, music, for example. Panoramas can also be used effectively to create a sense of a wider sense of depth. And wider, I'm specifically talking about width in the picture. They can create more rhythm, more interest, because you're limiting the eye not to moving up and down, but to moving left and right across the scene. Panoramas are also very easy to make complex. They're very easy to include too much. And so it's always important to keep a sense of simplicity in panoramas. Because when you have more simplicity, a lot of times you wind up having more interest. All right, and these are all examples of panoramas where I've eliminated parts of the picture that just weren't interesting, but there are elements in the pictures themselves that lend themselves to be viewed and looked at on a very wide, sense, left and right, not so much top and bottom. So, let's talk a little bit about the compositional toolbox, which is what I was alluding to before, right? There are certain things that we can use in our in composition, and this would be analogous, let's say, to things that we find in grammar, pronouns, nouns, adjectives, verbs, those kinds of things. A lot of these we've heard before, but it always bears repeating, even for myself, because I need to reinforce these all the time so that we can use these these elements not only better but simpler, so that we have lines, points and shapes, we have color, and we have patterns and textures. These are all sort of things that we can use in our composition. So here are some examples of some of these, one by one. Lines, right? Lines are really, really, really important when it comes to leading the eye through a scene. Leading the viewer through the things that you want to show them are most important. And these, the way that we can use lines and all of these things in general, but especially lines, can help to lead to bring out the subject matter. And the subject matter hopefully can then lead them to whatever it is that you're attracted to, whatever it is that is important to you. And if you're resonating with it on some emotional level, then hopefully that translates over to the viewer. Horizontal lines have a tendency or a sense of stability, because as humans, we tend to view the world along a horizontal axis because of gravity. Things that are horizontal are not going to fall, so they feel very stable. Things that are upright, not so much. Vertical lines can be stable because we see something that's vertical and not falling over as being strong because it isn't falling over. And diagonal lines are very energetic. Why? Because diagonal lines don't feel quite natural to us. I don't know about you, but if I walk into the woods and I see a huge tree that's at a diagonal, I try to see what's holding it up, because I don't want to be walking underneath it when it falls down, because you know that it wants to fall down. And that's what diagonal lines do in nature. They create a sense of tension and direction. you can use diagonal lines to lead the viewer into a picture. So we have, here we have a very strong diagonal line from the bottom right and also from the top right. Again, diagonals, right? There's a diagonal here leading the eye in from the bottom left, but I've also tried to use a line from the top right, and there are the line itself kind of moves through the image. It doesn't go from just one corner to the other. It moves either along areas of highlight and shadow or along areas of common color. And I want to talk about all those in a minute. So if you look at this picture as it, you started from the bottom left, you kind of follow the water until you get to what? The first thing that changes, which is the color. And then you get to green. And then within green, you have a couple of points there that kind of lead you back up to the top right-hand side. All right, so again, that's just using composition in a way that is design or designed. Here's not so much a diagonal, but just using lines leading in from what? The foreground to the background. One of the ways, if anyone's ever studied painting or drawing, one of the ways to show perspective is by putting things lower down in the frame and putting things higher up on the frame. And we sort of perceive things to be lower as closer and things to be higher as further away, because again, that's the way we kind of experience the world, right? We stand somewhere and things that are closer tend to be lower and then further away in the back. So you can use lines to emphasize that. And by emphasizing that, you create a picture that is more, what, dimensional, that has more depth to it. And by creating more depth, then you create the illusion that this is a three-dimensional space, and then you can bring the viewer into whatever it is that's most important in the picture. So that's a little bit of lines. And there isn't any specific image that just has one. So all of these images incorporate different things. I'm just highlighting the particular compositional element that I'm talking about. But I'll point out where I'm using more than one. So here, again, I want to talk about points and shapes now. Points and shapes create depth, they create balance, especially because shapes tend to be areas that attract the eye, and they can also create a sense of depth. A shape that's in front of another shape, a shape that's bigger than another, the way we line up shapes will lead the eye through an image. Upright triangles, believe it or not, if you've ever thought about it, have a strong sense of stability because they feel like they're anchored down to the ground, and triangles that are upside down, upright triangles is what I said before, upside down triangles want to, again, fall over. Circles can also be very powerful. They tend to attract the eye. So even when you look at this picture here, you notice there are a couple of almost circular shapes here. There's one here, there's one here, there's one here, there's even one here. And the reason why they attract the eye is because we tend to be attracted to circles, which can have implications based on how you want to compose your image. But in general, it's the shapes of this image that lead the eye, what? Again, diagonally, using a line, although it isn't a straight, simple line, it's a kind of an implied line, but it leads you diagonally from the front of the image towards the back, along this direction like this. It's the way the shapes are placed and the tonal differences and variances in the shapes themselves. Here's some more shapes, okay? Shapes, again, flowing diagonally through the picture. So the image kind of starts here, and your eye flows from front to back along a diagonal, bottom right, and also there's lines leading in from the left as well. So I'm always trying to find ways to anchor images diagonally, and that's always a good way for you to kind of establish an image and to simplify it, because sometimes in order for you to find those diagonals, those edges, you have to simplify your picture. Because if you start with a very complicated picture, the lines just aren't clear enough. And so that's a kind of a reminder to say, hey, how can I simplify this? Because removing stuff and having my lines or my diagonals stronger is going to make a stronger image in the long run. Points and shapes, once again, right? Here are lots and lots and lots of these rocks in the foreground, and these shapes, and due to the nature of their tonality and the shapes themselves, create sort of a sense of movement. But even with the fact that this looks like a jumble of rocks in the foreground, you can notice how I've tried to use the water as an edge to create, again, this line, a diagonal, with the shapes themselves, and same thing over here. You can definitely sense a certain direction with the lines here moving up towards the back of the picture and into the sky, okay? So again, just trying to use lots of circles. Okay, the rocks are circles, so you have a natural element there that the eye wants to see, that the eye enjoys looking at. And then how do you arrange them in a way that's simple enough, but still to have diagonals and lines? So we're building up everything that we can use in terms of the compositional toolbox, so to speak. One more with points and shapes. Again, remember I talked about circles, how circles attract the eye. So what here we have lots of little circles that create one big circle. Okay, so all of these little flowers here are lots of little circles, but then I try to create or make them into one big circle, which again leads the eye down from these rocks and into this area here. And it's really this little diagonal here along the top that actually is what anchors the image for me, because that's what kind of leads you in so that you feel like you have a way of getting into the image instead of it just being just about a bunch of flowers. I wanted to show the flowers in context, because again, I'm trying to show what I experienced as I was on this particular, you know, hike or wherever it was that I was at the time. Colors, that's another compositional tool that we can use in combination with the others. The more you simplify your colors, the more you can evoke certain emotions, because you don't have competing colors, right? So you can have a very warm image by using warm colors, a very cool image by limiting yourself down to cool colors. Obviously, color is something that is still not 100% understood. A lot of scientists think that it's psychological based, and I'm sure that it is, because we all see and react to color differently. There isn't a standard red that makes one person feel one way and one person feel another. So it is a very psychological component, which is why, you know, we have such a hard time saturating our images, because you try to remember what it looked like, but you also want to remember what it felt like. And that might be two different things. Your brain might be accentuating colors in the landscape because it makes you feel a certain way. And then you go back and you try to recreate that, and you might not find that it's exactly the way you remembered it. So another thing about colors from a compositional standpoint, especially from a sense of creating depth in your pictures, is that warm colors tend to move forward in the image and cool colors tend to recede. And if you're, again, thinking about depth, you can use colors to sort of create this sense of front to back, of foreground, middle ground, background, of moving the viewer through the image. And this image is really just about color. It's just the one thing that I wanted to try to capture is this sense of color and how I could use color to make the image feel like it has a dimension to it. And the little plants growing in the foreground here just add to that, because they have a little backlighting on them. And the backlighting is causing the shadows to fall downward. And backlighting is also a great way to, again, to increase this illusion of depth out of what is basically a two-dimensional image, especially if when I print it, you can really get a sense of that. Colors, once again, they can create and evoke a lot of emotion. This particular picture, I remember making it because it seemed like the colors changed every couple of minutes, so to speak. And this is an example to your question when you asked about like moving around with the camera. I really didn't have time to. So I really tried to focus on a composition that I liked, and then I tried to see what would happen with the color. And I waited until there was the majority of pink in the sky and in the reflection, even though later on it got a little less pink and a little greener, and it might have been more visually appealing, but it also was busier. And I wanted to try to keep it as simple as possible by limiting it down, by limiting the color palette, so to speak. And so that's, again, an example of using color in a way that you can try to evoke emotion. While you might think of this image as being relatively quiet, using a musical term, here's another example of an image that's much louder, so to speak, that has a lot more oomph to it because of the color. And not only because of the amount of color, but also the color itself. Pink tends to be much softer. Pink is actually a hue of red, right? Whereas here we've got a much purer red, not as tinted as pink is. And so the red tends to be very emotional. It tends to be very loud, very attractive. And so you can use that to kind of bring the viewer in to recognize and see large shapes. And that's what I've tried to do here. I've tried to make it about the color and silhouette the other shapes so that the color remains the strongest thing, and it simplifies it. If I try to show all of the detail in the foreground, at least from my perspective, my opinion, then the image becomes too busy, because now you've got all these different things to deal with. You've got to deal with not only the color, but also rocks and texture and detail. And it's like, wait a minute, it's overload. that's not how I perceived it when I was there. When I was there, I was looking at the detail in the rocks until the color came out. And once the color came out, I forgot about the detail in the rocks. That's what I want to bring across in the picture. What it is that me as a photographer, what I resonated with, and that's, again, what you should be thinking about as well. What do you resonate with? As an aside, for example, while I can say to you that that's what resonated with me because my senses sort of eliminated the texture in the rocks, if I use a camera and I expose for the whole thing, or even, I don't want to use the word worse, but even more so if I use HDR, right? Well, I'm now exposing for the entire scene, I'm capturing every tone in the image, and now you have to find a way to make sure that all that information can be communicated to the viewer simply. And that is a really, 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 really difficult thing to do, if not impossible, okay? So that's why there's nothing wrong with letting parts of your image help other parts of your image. That doesn't mean that they become unimportant, okay? It means that they allow other parts of your image to rise up. So notice how the black helps the color to be more vibrant, because black is what? An absence of color. And if you've got an absence of color, anything around it that has color is going to be even that much more interesting. I don't have to boost the saturation. I just need to reduce competing elements. Okay, patterns and textures. Here's another one that is really, really powerful. You can use patterns and textures to create rhythm. Okay, to lead the eye through an image through repetition, through rhythm. Rhythm keeps a viewer interested. Rhythm keeps a viewer exploring your picture. It makes them excited about the picture because it introduces a sense of movement. And if you're not moving, if your eye's not moving through an image, guess what? You get bored. Okay, movement doesn't have to be fast, it can be slow. So it isn't about creating very fast movement, it's just about creating the right kind of movement for the picture, and even more so for the story that you're trying to tell. Another thing about patterns and shapes and textures is that groups of threes tend to be harmonious in some way. So if you have a way to think about that is if you've got one thing in your picture, whatever that one thing is, but if you've only got one of it, well, it's going to attract the eye because it's one thing. It's solo. If you got two things, then it's even going to be more attractive because then you got two of them and they create a couple, and couples tend to stand out. But if you've got three or more, especially three, then it creates a pattern. And a pattern is much different than one or two because a pattern establishes some rhythm, establishes something that's a foundation in the picture. So here's an example of a lot of pattern with all of these little sharp needles of this yucca plant pointing up. It's the pattern of them that I tried to play with, even trying to create a diagonal using highlights and shadows. Okay. Here's another example of patterns and textures. Remember I mentioned groups of threes are stronger, and there are very subtle uses of groups of threes here. Why do I say that? Because when I was setting this picture up in this area of this dried up riverbed, was this area that I photographed is maybe, you know, I don't know, I want to say something like 3 by 3, maybe a little bit smaller, 2 feet by 2 feet, because I was basically with my tripod up in the air. But when I'm looking at this riverbed, it just looks like chaos. And like, okay, I like the way this looks, but how do I make a picture that's actually interesting? Well, you start looking at compositional toolbox, right? So there's a group of threes right here, right? These three shapes. There's another three shapes over here. There's another three shapes over here that are joined together. And then you notice that there are implied diagonals. There doesn't have to be right in the edge here. Each corner has sort of a sand area that leads the eye into what is most interesting to me, which is the contrast between smooth and texture, right? So again, putting all these different things together, but it's the patterns and the textures that helps to see more than what the individual elements of the picture is. So I've been talking a lot about relationships and arrangement with all of these things in the compositional toolbox, right? And there's one thing that's helped me a lot, which is this idea of, or it's a theory called Gestalt theory, which is this idea of how we perceive things visually so that we don't have to think about them too much. We just kind of take them in very quickly. And using things like contrasting elements, using things like visual rhythm, and these ideas of Gestalt can be very useful in being able to just internalize this idea of composition and be able to, again, see things a little bit easier. So here are, here are the kind of the basics of Gestalt. And from a compositional standpoint, from making pictures, again, it's useful to make your images simpler, more harmonious. Okay, that's another musical term. Things that are in harmony tend to work. They feel like they work. They belong together. Things that are in dissonance do not work together. Not that that's bad. You can create tension, but you have to do it. You have to do it the right way, not just by accident. One of the basic principles of Gestalt is it's called placement in proximity. That basically says that if you have a group of things that are close to each other, right, the way they're placed, then they take on a larger shape than each individual element, and that becomes a larger shape within your picture. I'll show you an example of these later. So if you've got a bunch of rocks together or a bunch of grasses growing together, the fact that they're all grouped create two larger elements that the eye takes in very quickly instead of looking at each individual rock, again, depending on how they're placed. There's another concept called similarity. That means that if you've got four rocks and three of them are one color and one rock is a different color, well, guess what? The eye or the brain is going to automatically group the three rocks of the same color into a larger group. And you can use that compositionally, okay? There's another principle that is called enclosure, and that means that if you've got groups of things and they are enclosed within something else, okay, whatever that other thing happens to be, whether it is the edge of a lake, whether it's separation between two mountains, if you've got three mountain ridges and you've got a bunch of trees and they're enclosed within those two mountain ridges, guess what? They become a unified shape unto themselves. And the last one is called continuation, which you've seen a lot, which means that if you've got a couple of things that form some sort of a line, well, the brain is almost always going to continue that line to where it goes. You don't have to have the line extending through the picture. Your brain will create an imaginary line because it's just the way it works. So here's an example of continuation, for example. You got a couple of shapes on the bottom right, and I want the eye to basically continue that line from the highlights to the shadows. I don't need to find another rock on the top left. It's just the two, three little rocks on the bottom that imply this line of continuation. So the energy of the picture, the movement of the picture, is from here up this way. It certainly isn't this way, although there are some shapes here, but you can see that this is kind of the natural way in which it feels more natural to move through the picture this way.
We don't see
your mouse. Oh, okay.
Yeah, we won't say the same thing.
Sorry.
You
say
that.
Okay. Sorry. So moving this way. That's what I meant. All right. So moving from the bottom right, that's kind of the natural direction of the eye. You can look at it from the other way too as well, because again, the more of these things you use in combination, the more interesting you can make a picture. But that's really kind of the way I established the picture compositionally. By establish, I mean simple. You bring your camera up to your eye. Where do you start? It's the first sentence in your story. That's where I started. If I can find an anchor, then now everything else is about moving the camera. It's about rotating the camera. It's about trying little changes in perspective, something that you cannot do once you're back home cropping the image. I could easily have photographed this whole thing and gone back and said, let me find the image. But if I find an image and I say, oh, but I really wanted this side of the rock because that side had the more interesting light, well, you ought to look. Here's another example of a picture where you step into a scene like this and there's this, you know, the elements in this picture are all around me, everywhere. I'm walking along this creek and it's just filled with ferns in every direction. It's so easy to make a picture that's just chaos. But again, when you talk about enclosure, when you enclose things with some element, they become groups. And I'm enclosing things in this picture by what? By the natural shadows that are in the picture. So if you find some shadows, that shadow creates a break. And because it creates a break, then you've got one element in the foreground, another element in the middle, and then the element in the background. You've created that sense of foreground, middle ground, background. With, of course, the inclusion of also some trees. But I really wanted to make a distinction between where I was standing and what else was in my scene. And where I was standing was right in front of these beautiful ferns growing all around me. There were more, but the more are just other ways to get you through the picture instead of wanting to show you the actual detail of them. I only wanted to express the detail in the foreground. Here's an example of, again, finding the picture in the field. So here is a scene that a time, a moment in place that I found myself in, and I knew that I had sort of the elements to make a good picture. Now, I should probably define that, because I know that sounds a little abstract. How do I know that I have the elements to make a good picture? Well, first and foremost, I probably have good light. If I don't have good light, and good light does not mean bright sunny skies like this or warm sunlight. It just means good light, period. It could be an overcast rainy day. If I find good light, then I know that I have the chance to make a good picture. There's always light. If you're in a cloudy, rainy day and you look under a leaf, the bottom of the leaf is going to be pretty dark. Where's your light? On top of the leaf. Okay? I'm just giving you a very basic example, but there's ways to find light, especially when you simplify. So light is the first thing. And the second thing that I use to sort of discern if I think I have a chance to make a good picture is that I can't seem to look anywhere else. Like, I'm attracted to this particular scene because I just like something about it that makes me emotionally attached in some way or another, whether that's a little bit or a lot. So this is my first attempt at this picture, because I've got some backlight coming into the scene, I've got some texture, I've got some rocks, I sort of like the overall shapes that I'm seeing here, I am enjoying the way it feels at the moment to be there making this picture, and that's my first attempt. Well, and this is happening in the field. I make my first attempt, and then I realize as soon as I snap the picture and I kind of look at the LCD just to get a sense of the composition that I haven't quite captured what it is that I want. So I make another attempt, which is this one here. So what have I done? I've gotten a little bit closer, a little simpler. I'm trying to simplify the image. But once again, I've got elements in the picture that are distracting, mostly that little bush growing in the foreground. I don't want the bush because the bush is not what I'm attracted to. It's not what is driving me to make the picture. So I make one more picture where I move in a lot closer, and that's the final image. That's the one that I want to keep because it limits the image down to the bare essentials of what I needed. Everything that I showed you in the first picture is still here, except it's much simpler and hopefully stronger from my perspective. It's got the light, it's got the shapes, it's got the shadows. It's got a very strong diagonal, much stronger than in the other pictures. Bottom left to top right, and I'm using the shadows in a way to move the viewer through the image from front to back. It's the light and the shadow that really is what drives the picture. The individual shapes themselves, it's just a question of lining them up in a way that looks visually appealing based on what I've said in the visual toolbox. Lines, repetition, rhythm, etc. Here's another example of a much more subtle example, which is something that I would have never noticed, let's say, I don't know, at some point in my past, right? before I made this mistake over and over and over again. Here's one picture, and this is nothing, the only thing changing in these pictures that I'm gonna show you is the movement of my camera, that's it. I'm not changing focal length or anything. Here's the first picture, and there's the second picture. And all I've done is rotate my camera slightly from one position to another. And if you look at the first one has very strong shapes, especially this shape in the top right, that is distracting the eye away from what I want to really zone in on, which is the arrangement of these trees. And also the trees don't have any particular rhythmic or grouping to them. Whereas if you look at the second image, now you can see very quite easily that these three trees here create like one sort of group, because I mentioned that groups of threes can be very strong compositionally. And then they lead to the other trees, which now take sort of a back, become complementary to the overall scene. So here's the one on the top left, which is the one that works compositionally more, and the one on the bottom right, which seems a little bit more random, if you will. All right, and that's a very subtle change in just the way you move your camera, which you cannot do that by cropping, because it's the rotation of the camera that changes the perspective between the trees, the relationship between the trees in terms of its angle and perspective. Give me a second. Here's one more about relationships and arrangement, how things are arranged. I show up at this lake in Acadia National Park. That's kind of the feel that I'm after, this feel of very calm and quiet and serene, but also very strong, stark shapes. And it's okay, but the movement of the eye isn't nearly as strong for me based on what I'm perceiving in person. when I look at the scene in person, I find and see a lot of movement. I take the picture lacks that. So I switch to vertical, right? Because most of the movement that I see is from where I am way into the distance. There's not so much left and right. The water is all in front of me. So I switch to a vertical perspective, and now I've got a little bit more movement, except that, again, I'm asking a lot of the viewer to perceive it the way I'm experiencing it by asking them to make this big jump from the foreground to the background, because the middle ground, clouds aren't that interesting. The light isn't that interesting in terms of the reflection of the clouds, and so that's a big gap there. It feels kind of empty. So, and I've also got this little rock on the top right that kind of doesn't want to be in and doesn't want to be out. I can't quite decide where it should be. So I make another picture in which I'm trying to eliminate that, but now I've changed the whole perspective of the picture because now it's even less direct, it's more ambiguous. So then I change once again to make that other rock the kind of the middle piece of the picture that I think I need. That takes the viewer from the front to the middle to the back, and I've also got a little bit more of a diagonal in the foreground now to create more movement in through the image. And those are all very subtle changes that I basically am making with the camera, moving maybe left and right, a foot maybe, okay? But if you've got a 24 millimeter lens, which is what this is, if you move a foot at 24 millimeters, you're gonna make a huge change in perspective, especially things that are further in the back. Okay, it changes the way the relationships and the way things relate to one another a whole lot. So, putting it all together, right? Putting all of these different compositional things together. Here we have what? Contrasting elements. What are the contrasting elements? They are the movement of the texture of the water, which is basically none, and the texture of the rocks. We've got moving and not moving. We've got sort of these two elements combining in one place, and that's what makes it kind of interesting. Plus, I'm using the panoramic format again. Why? Because I want to emphasize the movement left and right. I want the eye to scan across the entire horizon, not just the horizon, but the movement of the rocks left and right. Here's another example of using multiple elements. We got what? Proximity, which is what I mentioned before about gestalt. If you've got a bunch of things close to each other, then they become something that's bigger than each individual of those pylons. So it becomes a line now that moves your eye up in through the picture. You've also got contrasting elements. What is it? Color and non-color. You've got a lot of strong blue in the top. Why? Not necessarily because I added a lot of blue, but because there is an absence of blue in a lot of the rest of the picture. And because there's an absence of blue, then the blue that's there just becomes much more interesting. And simplicity, right? Fog is a great way to simplify images. If this particular picture right here, if you take the fog away, meaning if you go there like today, the other side of the river, this is the Hudson River, is full of stuff. There are, I don't know, buildings and oil tankers and all kinds of crap. But on a foggy day, it creates a complete simplicity, which gives me what I want, which is to create a sense of something more than what the location is, okay? Here's another example using visual rhythm, right? The way the eye moves through the image, you've got curves. Curves are sort of a line that isn't in a straight line that moves along a curve. And you've got enclosure, right? Because the tidal pool creates an enclosure around the clouds almost have a shape of their own. You don't really notice that it's a reflection. I mean, it is a reflection of the sky, but it's not a direct reflection. It's almost like it's a somewhat separate element. And again, very strong diagonal lines that create a very simple curve through the image. And contrasting elements again. Contrasting elements of what? A lot of texture, a lot of rock, a lot of contrast with a much softer part of the image up above. And that's why I divided the image in half. I haven't talked too much today about things like the rule of thirds. I think that's pretty self-explanatory, meaning that when they work, but otherwise ignore, right? I say that because I use them a lot. I use them a lot. This picture uses the rule of thirds. The reason why you don't notice it is because I'm just not using the rule of thirds. The left side of that tidal pool is on a third, the right side is on a third. But because there are other things happening in the picture, you kind of forget about the fact that it's thirds because there are other things happening that make it that much more interesting. It's only when you use something and you see it being used that it then becomes obvious. It's like if you see the tool, then you don't see the art, you just see the tool. All right, and I'm using that not for my own work, but for others because I'm just trying to make pictures, never mind what you want to label it. The other thing is we often hear about horizons. Don't place horizons down the middle, and I've probably broken that rule a whole lot today. Again, for the same reason, because when you break these rules, you don't think about breaking them. You just see something that's better. You see something that works better. I don't think about, okay, wait a minute, my horizon is halfway, or my horizon isn't halfway. Let me put it on the halfway mark so that I can break a rule. No, you just make a picture, and you find what works strongest in the picture, and it just so happens afterwards, you say, oh, look at that. The horizon is down the middle. I didn't even notice, okay? You may notice at first when you start to learn these things. After a while, you find the thing that's the strongest, and that's what the viewer sees, because nobody looking at your pictures knows what the rules are. They either respond or they don't. They either react or they don't. It either grabs them, it either gives them a sense of connection, or it doesn't. They're not going to stop and say, well, I could have connected if you would have put the horizon on a third. They don't say that. More visual rhythm, right? Lines and shapes. Movement, certainly movement. A lot of movement. I always try to find a way of leading the viewer through the image, like I said before. Movement from the foreground to the background. Texture and lack of texture. It's the combination of all the texture in the foreground with kind of the areas that don't have texture. As an example, I could have photographed this in a way that the whole bottom of the picture had a lot more texture, but I didn't want that, because then it would have become too busy. And number two, it's not about the texture, it's about bringing the eye up to the thing that is most emotionally attractive to me, which is this light that just crested over the horizon like 10 seconds ago. And all of a sudden went from making the scene and how I'm responding to the scene from a very sort of cool and subdued manner to now all of a sudden I'm excited because the sun just rose and that warm light is making me feel like wow, this is like a really good place to be right now. Like this is, life doesn't get much better than this. Here's a few more curves, right? Some basic curves, again, along a diagonal, C curves leading up into the image. There's similarity, there's enclosure. There's repeating patterns. You see the repeating patterns? There's one very powerful one, which is the curves in the foreground with the curves in the sky. And I have no problem giving all the credit to luck, because the clouds decided to give me lots of luck that day. However, if I show up at the scene, and I go here all the time, and I'm at this exact same place, but there are no clouds at all, then I don't make this picture. And I don't show you this picture because the picture doesn't quite work with all of the compositional elements. I make a different picture that does have the compositional elements. I might exclude a lot of the sky. I might show less of the sky. I might try to use the sky as negative space. So it's not getting lucky necessarily that makes the good picture. It's when you show up someplace in nature and you find things that, wow, I got lucky today. Now, how do I go about using what I know, using composition, to take advantage of the luck? And that's where the preparation comes in, right? That's where perspiration and opportunity becomes luck. All right, so again, using all those elements, and also one last thing here, black and white. People ask me about black and white all the time. I think of it just like composition, which means that compositionally, if I remove color from an image and the image gets stronger, then I probably will leave it in black and white. If I take the color out and the image loses something from its strength perspective, then I leave the color in. That may happen afterwards, it may happen before I make the picture. This particular picture, I kind of knew that I wanted it to be black and white when I was making it, because I could just see that the tones and everything was gonna work out pretty well. So in my mind, I said, okay, I think this is gonna be a black and white picture. Sometimes I go back and I see. And the reason why I try that is because I'm looking at a picture and I'm saying, wow, the shapes and the lines, everything look great, but the color just not doing anything for me. Let me see what happens if I take the color out and I convert it to black and white. So that's how I sort of go about deciding if I convert an image to black and white. But if I've got great color, then there's no need to, to converting to black and white, because I know that the color is a thing that makes the image come alive for me in one way or another. And that could be my own personal subjective opinion. It could be my experience, what have you. So I'm not saying there's a rule to it. It's just sort of the way I approach it. Think of everything, including color, as being a compositional element. And if color makes if the removal of color makes the image stronger, because now your lines and your shapes and the tonality becomes that much more interesting, then that maybe that's the direction that you can go in with a particular image. And lastly, before I show you a couple of examples, lastly, light. Light is the most important thing. I will say that unabashedly. I will say that even if you want to criticize me for it, I will still say it. Light is the most important thing. Without light, without interesting light, I have almost never seen a good picture. You can have great subject matter with light that isn't that interesting, and you're just going to have a mundane picture. But you can have the most mundane, the most everyday subject matter, and if you have great light, then you can make a picture that's interesting, because light is what gives, I think, especially in landscapes, it gives a picture its soul, so to speak. I don't mean soul in terms of something floating in the air, but I mean something that gives it a sense of resonance with the viewer. And whenever I'm out on my own, or wherever I'm out with students, and we're in a new place, and they're asking me where to start, or what do I see, or what do I suggest, or I don't know where to start, or I'm not sure, I always say, start with light. Look, use your eyes, look at the scene, and where is the light? Where is the light most interesting? If you've got, and we've had this experience many times, if you're in a canyon and there's no interesting light at all in the canyon, but there's one little speck of light in that corner over there, well, that's where you should be looking. Never mind all the texture and rocks, because that's just going to be uninteresting. And if it's uninteresting to you, it's going to be uninteresting to your viewer. Don't try to fabricate an interesting picture if you don't see it and experience it first. That's totally different, by the way, from interpreting an image in Lightroom. That's a totally separate thing. Okay, I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't try to do any interpretation in Lightroom. That's not what I'm saying. Interpreting an image in Lightroom means that you capture your composition in the camera, you got all your good ingredients, you got composition, lines, shapes, whatever, and now in Lightroom, or in Photoshop, or whatever your processor of choice is, you're now using those ingredients to interpret the image, to make the image more powerful, especially if you're shooting in RAW, because that's what we do. We capture we capture light with a digital tool, a sensor, and then we have to imbue it with some interpretation. Nothing wrong with that at all. What I'm saying is don't. You're going to be more frustrated than not when you try to manufacture images in the software that you didn't have the original ingredients to start with. If you've got the original ingredients, then you can go forward and you can experiment and you can add your own personality to it. Maybe you like more color, maybe you like more saturation, maybe you like more warmth, go for it. But you've already got it in the image, all right? So here's a couple of examples, right? All the movement that I want to create is this way, okay? Like this, right? And because I've got this shape here, which kind of complements this shape, this shape, this shape. So I'm looking at how this circle and the kind of the circular shape repeat over and over again to create repetition. Remember I mentioned before that circles are very powerful in an image. And no matter how you look at this image, this is the most powerful thing in the whole image. Why? Because it's a circle. So how do I balance that so that your eye just doesn't get sucked into this hole, right? So that the whole image in general, well, one way to do that is by having very strong light as a diagonal. Number two, notice how I've let the highlights and the sky blow out here. Because by letting the sky blow out, that becomes an area of high contrast, number one. Number two, any place that you kind of let the sky go white like that sort of implies kind of mystery or implies an aura about that part of the image that that pulls the eye in that direction. And I've got this tension between everything that you see down here and this area up here. Plus, I'm also very attracted to the shadows, because the shadows is what makes the light so evocative to me. And not only did I do that over here, but notice that I didn't blow out the whole sky. By blowing out the whole sky, that would have made the whole top of the image, the top of my frame, a distraction. Because remember, I said that there's no part of the image that isn't important. So I just wanted to make sure when I made this image, and technically I just was looking at my histogram to make sure that this wasn't blown out, that I had a little bit of blue here, a little bit of clouds, because now that adds just a little layer, and it adds the only place in the image that you don't see kind of that warm color and light, which is a little blue up here. And whenever you have blue, remember I said before, warm colors come forward, blue colors recede. So that kind of gives the image more sense of space and depth, okay? Let's go to another one. this one here, right? So horizon down the middle again. I didn't even notice that the horizon was in the middle. Why? Because I was reacting to shapes. Shapes and only shapes to start. Number one, I got, I have the shape right here, right? The bottom of the shape. Then I've got another shape in the center, a broad shape. Then I've got another shape in the back. That's foreground, middle ground, background. And I've got some additional minor shapes right here, okay? Also, I want the viewer to kind of see this image going this way back around to the distance. All right, and so you've got what contrasting elements. The contrasting elements are the detail and the color and the warmth of the foreground with almost the opposite of the top of the picture, which is absence of color, kind of very non-textured, very foggy, kind of very ephemeral, pushing the viewer back into the distance. So it creates a picture that's almost almost kind of surreal in a sense, because you don't really notice. I'm gonna take this out. You know, you don't really get a sense of the place. You just see like the foreground and the background and then the color. There's also a sense of repeating elements. There's a lot of texture here in the foreground. We talk about visual rhythm. You notice how the whole bottom of the image has like a lot of rhythmic movement to it, and then it slows down a lot when it gets to the top, because then I eliminate sort of the rhythm, or the picture itself doesn't have it, and it allows the eye to rest. If you've got this kind of texture repeating all the way to the top, boy, it almost gets laborious and tedious to look at a picture like that, because there's so much to explore. Giving the eye to rest allows you to return back to the bottom and explore the detail again. Here's another picture. So the movement here, right? The movement that I want to create is this kind of curve going back into the distance. It isn't the movement of the rock, it's the movement of the color in the water that I want. However, the rock here gives me a way to emphasize that, because I've got an edge. And because I have an edge, the eye is always going to move along an edge, because the eye always moves along areas of highest contrast. That's another way of creating strong lines. I've also got contrasting elements, right? I've got the contrast between all of this texture here and kind of almost kind of negative space, except it isn't negative. It's got texture, it's got color, and it's got another strong line. But it's got this sense of contrast, not contrast in terms of highlights and shadows, but contrast in terms of its texture and its movement. And finally, remember, we talked about implied diagonals. There's one right here, right through the middle of the image, okay? This shadow up here kind of cuts the image right down the middle, and I've also got it along the other side too. So again, multiple ways of dividing an image so that you don't give the viewer a choice, or very little choice, in experiencing the image the way you want them to see it. That's different from having an image that has other lines that are coming in, and now you're providing options, and maybe you're hoping inside that the viewer doesn't notice them, or you're thinking, oh, it's less distracting. You really have to be clear and precise about how you use your edges and your corners. One more. We're almost out of time. Let's look at this one right here. So one more image, right? What's the focal point of this image? What anchors the entire image? It's this rock right here. All right, that's where the image starts. That's where kind of I want the viewer to come in. That's why I've gotten my camera so close. Talked about perspective, right? So by getting my camera really close and low to the water, I'm actually in the water here, I want the movement to be this way, right? And then up. And this image is kind of similar to the other image, where there's a lot of rhythm in the foreground, but then it kind of slows down as you get to the top. The water kind of helps to emphasize that movement, because I'm using kind of a long exposure. Not that long, this is maybe 3 or 4 seconds, but long enough to blur the water. Why? Because if I blur the water enough, then I can create more contrast between the movement of the water and the static nature of the rocks. That also makes or helps to simplify the image, because now there isn't texture in the water that can distract from the texture in the rocks. Again, simplicity. And also there are a couple of triangles up here, or kind of implied triangles. Over here, there's one over here with the, and there's even a smaller one here. So all those shapes kind of help to make the image feel and look harmonious. And that's the key thing. And again, how you sort of lead the viewer through the image is the most important thing. So that's, again, another example here with this picture. So to finish up, just want to mention a couple of books that I think can be very helpful in learning about composition. One is The Essence of Photography by Bruce Barnbaum, right? That's a great book that came out recently. Any book by Bruce Barnbaum is going to be great, but this one is fairly recent. It talks a lot about, again, the aesthetics of composition, how important they are. So I highly recommend that. Another book is Drawing on the Right Side of the Brain by Betty Edwards. This is a book that's been out for a long time, but you would be amazed, and I'll give you a refund if you email me, if this doesn't prove to be true to you, but you'd be amazed at how much your photography can improve if you learn just some basic, simple drawing skills. Not to become an artist, but because when you learn how to shade things so that they have dimension, then you go into the field, into the landscape with a whole different perspective, because now you're looking for highlights and shadows, and you can recognize when the landscape looks more or most dimensional. And that's something that you have to learn in drawing, because drawing is a flat piece of paper. So you have to learn how to give things dimension. Finally, in terms of studying art, there's a great iPad app called Art Authority, which basically gives you a virtual museum in your iPad and lets you explore art through all the different eras and artists. And another, it's a great way if you're sitting at home on a rainy day and you're tired of looking at popular photography, which would be a horrible day to spend your horrible way to spend your rainy day. Look at a bunch of art. Just take it in. You don't realize that everything that you feed into your brain is going to have some effect later on. And the better the ideas you put into your head, the more you'll be able to utilize those later. One more book, The Simple Secret to Better Painting, is another great book that talks a lot about composition and visual design. Not so you can paint, but again, it talks about a lot of the things that I talked about. And then one last book is my own book that just came out about 2 months ago, which is called Insights from the Creative Path. I talk about not only composition, but I also talk about this whole journey of creativity and how to sort of combine the two things, meaning combining trying to be creative from sort of an ideal standpoint to how you actually implement that in the field when you're standing in front of the ocean or a landscape or a lake or what have you. And you can check that out on my website as well. So two last quotes to finish, because I love quotes. It took me 4 years to paint like Raphael, but a lifetime to paint like a child. And children are the best artists because they don't criticize, they don't self-criticize, they don't judge, they don't hold things back. They're not ashamed, they're not embarrassed. They just do it freely and share it with everyone else. And then we grow up and we get too afraid of being ourselves and we try to see what others are doing. So thank you very much for coming. And
whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.